My first exposure to forfeiture is I'm often counsel to certain organized groups of motorcycle enthusiasts, and those particular angels are often at the in the crosshairs of the government who is trying to take their hard-earned property. So Shawna approached me one day and said, "Craig, you'll never believe this case that I've got. What do you know about civil forfeiture?" And I said, "Well, I know a lot about criminal forfeiture. Is it like that?" And she said, "I think so. It's kind of like that, and we're both litigators. Let's get into this." And the story is this. There's this lovely couple, and they've bought and own a whole series of properties around Orillia. And five of them are being used for income properties that are sort of small apartment buildings, small complexes. And two more, these people, we say out of the goodness of their heart, have reserved them for low-income families and low-income persons and said, "We shall, you know, we're looking to the Bible, the poor, they shall always be with us, and we shall make sure they have a home." And they do that. And the poor, in this case, come with a host of social problems. They have alcohol addiction issues, drug addiction issues, mental health issues, and to self-medicate they use drugs and they use alcohol, and to get some money they even sell drugs. And sometimes they do these things in and around these buildings. And the police in Orillia don't like this at all, but aren't having a lot of success just making arrests for, you know, selling a 20 piece of crack and getting a short sentence and the person's right back where they were. So the Attorney General in Ontario launches an action, an application to seize this property, saying, "Well, you sell drugs there and the landlord takes the money from the drug dealers, therefore this is offense-related property and it's ours." Good one, huh? So to understand, and they do this under an instrument called the Civil Remedies Act. I don't know if any of you are familiar with it, but to understand how nefarious this particular piece of legislation is, I'd like to explain to you first the way that forfeiture works in the criminal code. And I thought, what better way to really grip an audience first thing in the morning than to read to you from the provisions of the criminal code? So, 462.37. There is a section in the criminal code that deals with seizing property, and it's 462.37. And where an offender is convicted, I'll say it a third time, convicted of a designated offense, the court imposing sentence, so following a trial, at the sentencing proceedings, is satisfied by the Attorney General, and this is on a balance of probabilities, after a conviction though, that it was the proceeds of crime, then the court shall order, mandatory provision, shall order forfeiture of it in relation to the following conviction on designated offenses. Where the evidence does not establish that the to the satisfaction of court that the designated offense was committed in relation to that property, then the court may, well, permissive section of the criminal code. Alternatively, there's section 490 of the code where the court is satisfied on a balance of probabilities that any property is offense-related property and that the offense was committed in relation to that property, then the court, then in relation to other indictable offenses, is satisfied beyond a reasonable doubt, they may make an order. Okay, so fairly solid protections. You can still lose your property under the criminal code, but there's a very rigorous procedure that's imposed on the government. So there's a permissive section following convictions usually, and where it doesn't follow a conviction, then it's you still have to tie them to the offense, and it's only a permissive may order. Then under the CDSA, the Controlled Drugs and Substances Act, separate piece of legislation. So often, I don't know how many of you practice criminal law, when you're dealing with criminal code offenses and these designated offenses, which relate mostly to property offenses and possession of proceeds of crime and things like that, it's always a provincial crown that prosecutes these things, and it's provincial crowns that have access to the criminal code and use this as a tool. Federally, you have the Controlled Drugs and Substances Act, and under section 16 of the Controlled Drugs and Substances Act, where the court is satisfied that the property is offense-related property and the offense was committed in relation to that property, then the court can order, okay, permissive section again, can order the disposition of the property. So the question, basically there are three questions that get put before a court. Is the property the proceeds of crime? Was there an offense committed in relation to that? And is the property then offense-related property? And if all that is satisfied, then the court has broad broad powers to order forfeiture, but doesn't have to. Okay? So once offense-related property, it's defined in the criminal code as any property that is used in any manner in connection with a criminal offense. Similarly, under the CDSA, by means of, in respect of property, by means of, in respect of which a designated substance offense is committed. Okay, so if you're using a house as a grow-op, if you're using your house to store large quantities of cocaine, these can be offense-related property. In a case called Old Navy Corporation versus the Attorney General, where they had some schmuck named Craig Bottomley as their lawyer, the government went after the Hell's Angels Clubhouse on Eastern Avenue following a very long trial where they also had the same guy as their lawyer. At the trial, the jury came back and said not guilty to every single count of criminal organization before the court. And there were about 37 different counts of criminal organization. There were five different accused. Not guilty, not guilty, not guilty, not guilty. Each of them were found guilty of one or two drug-related offenses. In my in my client's case, he had encouraged a member who owed money to a gangster out in BC. My client is wiretapped at a meeting. The police had flipped the guy who is the sergeant-at-arms of the Toronto chapter of the Hells Angels and said they paid him $1 million, and he said, yeah, I'll be your guy. And he's the guy that comes into all the meetings and takes the wand and sweeps the room and goes, yeah, we're clear. And then would sit down with the wire in his jacket. Let's talk. And it's a good move. and the my client is heard in a conversation saying, listen, if you owe a guy money, you gotta pay him his money. It doesn't matter if it's for your car or for your bike, if it's your mechanic or your lawyer, which I was happy to hear, or this guy out in BC. You gave your word, pay your money. He's found guilty of trafficking in a substance called GHB, which is the date rape drug, but it's used for all sorts of different liters of it. And that was his involvement. Okay, was encouraging this payment. And they said, aha, we got him on something. So he's convicted of that one offense and acquitted of all the criminal charges. And the Attorney General in the sentencing makes an application under the CDSA, and the judge finds because they used they would never hold these meetings at the clubhouse where they were going to talk about anything illegal. They would always go off site when they, for some reason, they managed to get their way into an insurance company boardroom, which I'm sure that insurance company now has a police officer parked outside every day staring through the front doors trying to figure out why. But the judge said because they met at the clubhouse and had discussions there about moving to the next location where they would have the meeting, the clubhouse was a hub of criminal activity. That was the word she used in the judgment. Very fair judge, very good judge, but I didn't agree with this ruling. And ordered complete seizure of a $700,000 clubhouse. Okay, so the Hells Angels now rent. This is the ways in which it's done for the federal government and for the provincial government. There are, in both cases, under both pieces of legislation, there are proportionality provisions that some of you may be familiar with, a trilogy of cases out of the Supreme Court of Canada, Craig, Ouellette, and Nguyen, which talk about proportionality. Far better when the litigant is not a fat guy with a beard and a lot of tattoos and a motorcycle, but a housewife from British Columbia who's suffering from depression and grows marijuana inside to pay her bills. And the code and the court say that the nature and gravity of the offense, the circumstances surrounding the commission of the offense, and the criminal record of the person and any link to criminal organization charges may be considered in determining what proportion of the real property can be surrendered to the state. So that's broadly speaking. There are minutiae to this, but broadly speaking, those are the criminal code and the CDSA provisions that govern forfeiture. Compare that with what Shawna's going to tell you about the sort of the parameters of the Civil Remedies Act, which is a very short act.
The Civil Remedies Act, which is our province's civil forfeiture legislation, was enacted in 2001. The CRA essentially created a civil forfeiture scheme which allows the Attorney General of Ontario to initiate in rem proceedings in the Superior Court to preserve and forfeit proceeds and or instruments of unlawful activity. And unlike the asset forfeiture legislation that Craig was just talking about under the Criminal Code of Canada or the Controlled Drugs and Substances Act, the Civil Remedies Act focuses solely on the connection between property and unlawful activity. It's not dependent on any criminal convictions or even the laying of a criminal charge. This fact is so important, I feel obliged to repeat it. No criminal charge or conviction must precede a forfeiture application. In fact, even where a criminal charge is in fact pursued and an acquittal is the end result, your property is still fair game when it comes to the Civil Remedies Act. Even more disturbing than that is the fact that the standard of proof required for civil forfeiture is identical to those applied in all civil actions, and it's a balance of probabilities, a far cry from the proof beyond a reasonable doubt standard employed in criminal law. There's no presumption of innocence. The Attorney General can even have the court order property sold before the forfeiture proceedings have even been decided, and often do. The case that Craig mentioned at the beginning, which is
which isn't over yet, so we have to be a little careful.
Right.
And there's a camera here I saw, so we're
noticed that. So I'm going to be very general, but essentially it's about landlords who, as Craig mentioned, reserved a certain number of their properties for low-income individuals. The landlords are a married couple, no criminal record whatsoever, salt of the earth people. The type of people who drive their clients to detox in AA and take them grocery shopping and give them little jobs to help them, you know, earn some income and raise their self-esteem. In any event, in that case, although it continues, the two properties at issue that were seized, an order has been made that they be sold in advance of the ultimate disposition even being made. So their properties are gone. No matter what the ultimate judgment is in this case, those properties will be gone.
The money is just paid into the court and sits there. But in the meantime, once sold, the people who were living there, who were kicked out under the preservation order, are just gone.
Yep.
Nowhere to live. So the government at this point, by this action, has created homeless people.
And the city where it occurred in Orillia already had a huge homeless problem at the time. In any event, unbelievably, the courts have held that this is not punitive legislation. The fact is, the Civil Remedies Act is pith and substance criminal law with none of the protections the federal legislation provides. In terms of how the statutory framework works, it essentially allows the Attorney General to ask the civil court for an order to freeze, take possession of, and forfeit to the Crown property that is determined to be a proceed or an instrument of unlawful activity. A proceed is defined as property, such as money, that is acquired as a result of unlawful activity. An instrument is property that is likely to be used to engage in unlawful activity, such as a house used as a marijuana grow operation, or a car used in an impaired driving case. Property includes all types of assets, such as real estate, cash, cars, electronics. For the sake of brevity, I'm not going to take you through all the sections of the criminal, the Civil Remedies Act. I do, however, think it important to briefly go through the stated purpose of this legislation. According to Part 1, the purpose of this act is to provide civil remedies that will assist in A, compensating persons who suffer pecuniary or non-pecuniary losses as a result of unlawful activities, so essentially compensating victims. B, preventing persons who engage in unlawful activities and others from keeping property that was acquired as a result of unlawful activities. C, preventing property from being used to engage in certain unlawful activities. And D, preventing injury to the public that may result from conspiracies to engage in unlawful activities. So instrument, essentially in this act, means property that is likely to be used to engage in activity, an unlawful activity that in turn would be likely to or is intended to result in the acquisition of other property or in serious bodily harm to any person. According to Section 8 of the Civil Remedies Act, in a proceeding commenced by the Attorney General, the Superior Court of Justice shall, subject to subsection 3, and except where it would clearly not be in the interest of justice, make an order forfeiting property that is in Ontario to the Crown in right of Ontario, if the courts find that the property is an instrument of unlawful activity. And again, I just want to remind you what the onus and the standard is on a balance of probabilities. There's a two-part test for granting a preservation order, and it is whether there are reasonable grounds to believe the property is a proceed or instrument of unlawful activity, and where such grounds exist, the court shall make the order, unless it is clearly not in the interests of justice to do so.
Am I right that those applications are ex parte?
They are.
Yeah, so that's not only do you have that standard, but you have that standard where you don't know what's going on, right?
Initially.
The person that owned, and these are for people's homes, right? And the government steps in, and the preservation order at the beginning, which always entails a piece of you shall not dispose of this property, you won't sell this property, and you can't go into this property in a lot of cases. So, and which was the case in Riley, that you can't attend there. And this is not uncommon. And all that happens ex parte at the front end, before the application. No charge laid, no conviction rendered, no presence at the application. Now we'll get on to deciding whose property it is.
With respect to civil forfeiture in Canada, at present all provinces, with the exception of Newfoundland and Prince Edward Island, have implemented their own versions of civil forfeiture legislation. Ontario was the first. British Columbia, I believe, was the second. Studies have shown that civil forfeiture legislation has been implemented in Canada demonstrates that the British Columbia and the Ontario programs still remain the most extensive and controversial, with British Columbia going even further than Ontario. My understanding is that in British Columbia, there are even quotas with respect to how the Civil Remedies, CREA here, the Civil Remedies Office, operates.
If you search Quick Law for these applications, you'll find that they are almost exclusively British Columbia and Ontario decisions, with, I would say, more of them coming from British Columbia.
Now, despite the fact that this legislation has been around since 2002, almost 15 years, and considering the enormous revenue, which I'll get into a little bit later, the legislation is bringing in, one may find it surprising that the average citizen has absolutely no idea that this legislation even exists. I'm sure most landlords would be pressed to consider whether they wish to have income properties, especially if they're out of province, given this legislation. Unfortunately, and in the case that Craig and I have been involved in, it's amazing. The police can't make arrests, despite the fact that they are doing surveillance for over a year, can barely make any drug-related arrests. But they expect the landlords who don't live there, who employ property managers, who keep the properties up to code, involved landlords who do go there every once in a while.
Who are prohibited by law from entering into the apartments where the drug would be, right? You're not allowed to go into someone's home and, hi, I'm here to make sure everything's clean and orderly and that you're not selling crack. You would get sued,
yeah.
Right?
They expect them to somehow be able to deal with these issues when the police can't themselves. And obviously the police have far more resources, search warrants, you know, the like, at their disposal.
It's not Greenwin properties that they're going after. It's not corporate property owners so far that they're going after. But the test case, the targets are, you know, they're not poor people, but they can't afford years and years and years of litigation.
No. Most of the individuals who are residing at either of the two properties that have been forfeited and now ordered to be sold were people who were on Ontario disability or on welfare. And although the Attorney General has suggested that this is not just an instrument case but also a proceeds case, it
because the rent is being paid with drug money, they say.
Yet the rent for almost the majority of tenants is actually being paid
by the government.
By the provincial government. So,
who's taking it from drug dealers? So they're right.
Now, I was just saying, the fact is the great majority of forfeiture applications settle or aren't defended against. This is in large part due to the huge costs of litigation. The provincial government is a formidable adversary with unlimited resources. And since proceedings under the Civil Remedies Act masquerade as civil proceedings as opposed to criminal, legal aid likely isn't even an option for these individuals. So one of the reasons I think that many of us are still in the dark about the Civil Remedies Act and its huge reach is because most things are settled, or people just say, okay, take it, and we don't hear much about it. That's very scary. The Attorney General boasts about the success of this legislation on their websites, and earlier, I was talking about the purported purposes of the legislation, which I took you through. With that in mind, I now wish to examine how the money and assets that are seized are actually being used and who's really benefiting from all the money that the Civil Remedies Office takes in. So, in 2013, 41.5% of the money seized went to grants to law enforcement agencies. 27.5% were funds remaining in government accounts. 23.7% went into program cost recovery.
So paying for the properties that they're managing, right? Because they're in charge of managing the properties, so they use the money that they make to manage other properties.
7.2% went to victims' compensation of all that money. the stats for 2012 and 2013 are almost identical.
There's actually a little bit of a troubling trend. There's a I take in a lot of students from Osgoode who were forced to do hours at my office for some public interest reason that I don't understand, but I take advantage of it. One of the ones that's there now was fortunate enough to have someone named Marnie Supkoff come and speak at one of their classes, and he forwarded me a PowerPoint presentation, and what you can see is every single category for the 2 years that Ms. Supkoff looked at go up, except for victims' compensation, which went down. Little trend.
Since November 2003, a total of 37.6 million in property has been forfeited to the Crown as a result of the Civil Remedies Act. This doesn't even factor in the additional approximately 24.5 million in property that is currently frozen pending completion of particular civil forfeiture proceedings. BC in 2014 brought in $41 million. Not insignificant amounts.
Just to be fair, in the Toronto housing market is only about six properties, but still.
We should be very, very concerned about the reach of this legislation and about the fairness and the increasingly suspect seizures of property deemed to be either an instrument or proceeds of crime. Oh, and I also we should be increasingly concerned that the federal forfeiture provisions, such as those that Craig reviewed at the outset with respect to the under the Criminal Code or under the Controlled Drugs and Substances Act, don't get displaced by the Civil Remedies Act with its lower threshold of proof. Please remember that this act allows the provincial government to seize your car, boat, home without even securing a conviction, often without even laying a criminal charge. In my opinion, the Civil Remedies Act represents one of the most serious assaults on private property rights. And it invites significant abuses. And from where I stand, I don't think there's anything that can be done to amend or change or fix this legislation. It should be abolished. Now, nearly from the start, there have been serious concerns regarding the constitutionality of this legislation, and Mr. Bottomley will now be addressing those issues.
She's the gloomy one, I'm the sneaky one. Because I promise that at the end of this, I'm going to leave you with a ray of hope for the litigators in the room. Anyway, the academics, you're screwed. But for the litigators, I have thought of something that I think is, I think the nice way that judges say it was, well, that's very novel, Mr. Bottomley. And I'm going to get to that. We'll leave you with a ray of hope. But before I do, the most troubling thing that I think Shawna said, it's bad enough that you can never have a charge laid and you can never ever be convicted of anything and go. What horrifies me is you can be acquitted. You can be acquitted and they can proceed civilly, right? There is a case out of the Supreme Court of Canada. It is one of our fundamental tenets in criminal law, and it's a case called Gerdic, G-R-D-I-C, who was convicted of needing to buy a vowel. But other than that, he was acquitted otherwise of all criminal matters. And that case went up to the Supreme Court of Canada, where the ratio that comes out of Gerdic is, when you are acquitted, you are acquitted for all purposes. It is a declaration of innocence. We do not have different degrees of not guilty. Not guilty is an exoneration. Not guilty means you didn't do these bad things. Not so fast, says the provincial government. Aha, says the provincial government, we'll sneak in with the, and I respect that. I respect the sneakiness, but we're gonna sneak in with the CRA. And I say CRA and everyone thinks Canada Revenue Agency, but we mean the Civil Remedies Act. People call it CREA, and I always think of a South Asian nation, and I can't get it straight. The other thing that Ms. Fattal said is that the pith and substance of this, which is the language we're all familiar with from constitutional litigation, the pith and substance of this is criminal law. I agree with her, but there's these nine robed people in Ottawa who flatly disagree with her. There's a case, you may very well be familiar with it, called Chatterjee. And Chatterjee, the argument was brought on by Mr. Chatterjee. Mr. Chatterjee gets pulled over in his car, and he's got a couple of things that might look, if you knew anything about how grow operations worked, and you saw a ballast and a fan, and $20,000, and he didn't really care, I don't think, about losing his fan to the provincial government, but the $20,000 in cash he was a bit more concerned about, and it goes up to the Supreme Court of Canada. So I think Mr. Chatterjee must have had other sources of income, because no one's going that high for 20 grand. But the argument that's brought by Mr. Chatterjee and loses at every level, including the Supreme Court of Canada, is this legislation is ultra vires of the provincial government. It is outside of their scope of constitutionally approved legislation. When you're dealing, criminal law is squarely the jurisprudence of the federal government. It's weird because I want to say the province of the federal government, but that gets confusing. It is the under the sphere of the federal government. Only they shall legislate when it comes to crime. And Chatterjee lost at the Supreme Court of Canada because the court said the evident purposes of the CRA are to make crime in general unprofitable, not to penalize criminals, but to make crime unprofitable, to capture the resources tainted by crime so as to make them unavailable to fund future crime and to help compensate private individuals, and we all know how well that's going with our whopping 7%, and public institutions for the cost of past crime. The practical and intended effect to take the profit out of crime and to deter its present and would-be perpetrators, these are valid provincial objectives. Crimes create costs to victims and the public that would otherwise fall on the provincial treasury, including health, policing resources, community stability, and family welfare. Well, they certainly seem to have figured out where they're giving the money because it's all gone to police resources. None of it's gone to family welfare, as far as I can tell. It would be out of step with modern realities to conclude that a province must shoulder the costs of to the community of criminal behavior, but cannot take legislative steps to suppress it. That's what they say. Chatterjee had argued that it interferes with the administration of proper government and proper legislation, to allow the CRA to really, because what they're doing is stepping into the criminal code sphere. And that argument was soundly rejected by a unanimous Supreme Court of Canada. If anyone's really interested, it's 2009, 1 SCR 624. The sections that will upset you, the paragraphs that will upset you occur between sort of 40 and 60. So that's the CRA. The Supreme Court of Canada says, no, the deterrence here, the deterrent effect and the rehabilitative effect is properly the province of the province, and go ahead. And then a bad thing happened in Barrie. Any of you guys know about the Molson Brewery grow up? So much weed. The Molson Brewery, so someone buys the Molson Brewery, a company called Furcan, F-E-R-C-A-N, buys the Molson Brewery, and nothing's going on in a large portion of the Molson Brewery. And it's a huge facility, like the kettles alone. There are pictures you can see on YouTube of the kettles going up the highway on these monstrous trucks. The kettles are twice the size of this hall, okay? They're huge, I'm not joking. I know it's hard to tell the difference sometimes, but I'm not joking. And full of weed. Biggest grow op discovered up till that point. And a line of U of T students from here to Barrie. And they prosecute Furcan. And they say they try to seize this property under the CDSA. And they hire Brian Greenspan. Brian Greenspan is a goddamn genius. Brian Greenspan turns around and says, okay, if the forfeiture provisions of the CRA, if forfeiture like this is properly the sphere of the province, then you can't use it under the CDSA. Didn't work. But it was brilliant. It's a great idea, and for the exact same reasoning, or the exact inverse reasoning, the court said, no, this is crime deterrence, and properly the sphere of the federal government. Sit down, Mr. Greenspan. Okay? And that was that. And that's a decision now, to be fair, that's not a Supreme Court of Canada decision. That's a decision out of the Newmarket Court of Justice by a very good, very defense-friendly judge named Peter West. And Justice West's decision can be found at 2012 OJ number 6709. Don't just quick law Furcan, because you'll get about 16 different decisions back. So the court dismissed the application, upheld Section 16 and 19 of the CDSA, saying they're not ultra vires of the federal government this time and can still function. I would like to tell you that Brian went on to win the rest of the trial, said that it showed that Furcan had no idea what these other couple of scoundrels were doing when they were allowing people to grow this massive quantity of weed. Because these guys pled guilty to it over here, and Furcan, who owned the property, said, we didn't know they were doing this. Like, you got a dirty night guard who's sneaking these guys in to set up a grow up in an abandoned section of the plant. So West held that the actual property owners were innocent, i.e. not complicit, which is the wording you need, of any involvement in the marijuana production. The property was ordered returned, because they were trying to seize the entire Barry Molson Canada plant, and beautifully, costs were ordered against the Crown. And you civil people in the audience who think, yeah, we get costs every time someone says no thank you, in criminal matters, costs never get awarded. You can only have costs. There are two ways. One is as a remedy under Section 24.1 of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms, you can have costs awarded. I've been involved in one case where we were granted costs, and it was quickly overturned at the Court of Appeal. You never spend the costs in criminal law. You always put them into trust and wait, because they're going back to the Crown eventually. And the other way is the Crown acts in a completely unreasonable manner. There was no charter application in this matter. Justice West said the Crown, I find it's not ultra vires, but I also found the Crown has behaved completely unreasonably, and I'm ordering costs against the Crown, and denied the application. So there's also another sort of novel approach to strike. Now, because not only does Chatterjee say Chatterjee being the first case I talked about, not only does Chatterjee say that it's not ultra vires, but Chatterjee also tacitly, they're not super explicit about it, but I say they tacitly approve of the burden and the onus that's set out in the CRA, that being you don't have to be charged and it's proved on a balance of probabilities, which for a criminal defense lawyer is a shocking thing to hear. So in a case called Lee, L-E, out of the Superior Court of Justice, here in Ontario, 2006 OJ number 2789, there was an application by Mr. Lee that the force and effect, the section 462.37, that first section of the criminal code I talked about when you all stopped listening, was of no force and effect because it operated contrary to Section 7 of the Charter, your right to life, liberty, security of person, and Section 12, which is cruel and unusual. And what he was arguing was where, so in that case, they had recovered $124,000 worth of money and 2.68 kilograms of cocaine, which is worth about $90,000, depending on your market. The monies that they tried to seize these monies, and the way the court did it was they said you owe the full amount of the money, and you owe the full amount of the money, and you owe the full amount of the money, and you owe the full amount of the money to these four different accused. thereby ensuring the government would get their money. But Mr. Lee argued, well, no, that puts me at a, I'm on the hook for more, I was only involved for $10,000. And the court very literally said, in for a penny, in for a pound. And if you're in it, you're in it for the full extent of the criminal enterprise. And if the province gets unjustly enriched, well, that's too bad for you. And if you have to pay more than you were in for, too bad for you. And the application fails. That is the extent of the constitutional arguments I can find challenging the full legislation in a broad sense. There seems to me to be little hope there unless there are some seriously new facts or someone come up with something really creative that I have been able to think of. You're in trouble on a wide scale, full frontal constitutional attack on this legislation. So that's the doom and gloom. Here's the beginning of the ray of hope. What about charter breaches? And this is our bread and butter. This is where criminal lawyers live and die. Is on section, generally speaking, 8, 9, and 10B of the Charter, search and seizure, arbitrary detention, and right to counsel issues. So what happens where the Charter is breached in relation to the seizure of the property? Okay? And I'll tell you right now, the civil crown's response at the front end is going to be, the Charter applies, the Charter protects people, not places. Okay, the Charter protects privacy interests, not property. Okay, and I'm going to get to that. There's a case called La Roche out of the Supreme Court of Canada, 2002, 3 SCR 708. And La Roche operates Garage Côté La Roche in Quebec, and they're a body shop. But they were doing some shady things and were putting through false documents and defrauding the system for money. How it happens doesn't matter, but they were being naughty, as we say in criminal law. That's a very technical term. The police apply for a special warrant to seize the property and the vehicles where all this was going on. And what the court in La Roche ultimately decides is that special warrant seizures of property constitute a seizure within the meaning of the Charter. So all of a sudden, Section 8 applies. You don't have to have a search and a seizure, search or a seizure. So once the government has seized your property, that's a seizure, okay? And this is good news, because even though holding property is okay, but the way in which they seize it has to be Charter compliant. Because if it's not, they open themselves up to remedies under Section 24 of the Charter. So, what's really interesting is, so now you can go review the seizure. You can take it before a judge and say, I want this looked at, I don't think it meets Charter scrutiny. When you do that in a lot of criminal contexts, and I'll give you the example of wiretaps. If I apply to a judge and say, these scoundrels misled the court about all these things in their affidavit to get the wiretap authorization. And the court says, by golly, Mr. Bottomley, you're right. Let's scratch those things out. The test from Garofoli, or Garofoli for my Italian friends in the audience, is could the issuing judge still have granted the warrant? The answer is almost always yes. Okay? Garofoli lost Garofoli. In the last 5 years in Ontario, there has been one successful challenge to wiretaps in a case called eBanks by Justice Trafford at the Superior Court of Justice that was overturned in firm fashion by the Court of Appeal. This standard of review sucks for criminal litigants. What they say in La Roche is the reviewing judge, and what judges always say, Mr. Bottomley, it's not up to me to decide would I have granted the authorization. The standard is, could the issuing justice? Well, yeah, he could have, right? That's the standard. In La Roche, they say the reviewing justice must decide whether he or she would have made the same decision as the authorizing judge, having regard to all the evidence in the judge's possession following the hearing. If the reviewing judge is of a different opinion, he or she must correct the initial error. The applicant bears the burden of establishing on a balance of probabilities, and we're the applicant here, So we have the balance of probabilities now, that the authorization should not have been granted. The applicant must demolish the appearance of validity attached to the authorization. So you're in a far better position than in most criminal cases to attack seizures by the government using Section 8 of the Charter, and you can apply for, and this opens the door, I say, this often overlooked 2002 decision from the Supreme Court opens the door to charter remedies and standing on property issues. Now, as I say, the Crown will say the law, the charter protects people, not places, privacy, not property, and there is simply no charter right against the, and this is right, there is simply no charter right against the unlawful detention of property or the use of it by the Crown or the police. Where Section 8 rights arise is in relation to the process surrounding the search and seizure, not the detention of the property. So, I don't mean to be glib, but where this happens in the criminal law process is the cops pull over someone, and it just happens to be a black guy driving a nice car for reasons that they can't clearly articulate. And before they even pulled him over, they were running his criminal records check. That is charter violative behavior. When they search the car on this Section 9 violative stop, on this arbitrary detention, the search then becomes an unreasonable search. When they find the $100,000 and the handgun in the duffel bag underneath him, and they make the application to seize the property, this is where you can strike. Okay? Now, this may sound unpalatable to some of you because you think, well, you guy had a gun. He had a gun and a kilo of coke in with that 100 grand in cash. Surely the government should seize it. You protect him to protect the Rileys. Okay, you protect him to protect the couple up in Orillia to make sure that the standard remains robust. And you must tie your remedy to your process. I'm getting the 5-minute flag here, so I'll tell you one more thing. This is the real ray of hope. So that's part of the ray of hope, is tie the charter to your litigation. Don't challenge the constitutionally wholesale. Because when's the last time, with the exception of Bedford, that they struck down a whole section of the act? It's not like they struck down the whole criminal code. I think pimping is still illegal. I'm not sure. here's the real sneaky thing that I've thought of that I hope to you is worth the price of admission if you're at all interested in criminal law. Section 490 sub 7 of the criminal code sets out provisions for the detention, the seizure of things seized by the police. Okay, in those applications, so the police execute a warrant or seize property, doesn't matter how they do it, a 90-day clock starts ticking under the criminal code, where they're allowed to just hang on to that thing. You can write to them and say, can we have it back, and they usually ignore your letter. But it's often those materials that are seized that the people over at Crown Law Civil will start an application on in relation to that property and say, that's the stuff we want. But civil lawyers and the civil process, in comparison to criminal law, moves kind of slowly. Mm-hmm. Wait your 90 days, and don't wait a minute longer. And make your application under 490 sub 7 of the criminal code for the return of the property seized before the civil lawyers think to do it. Because once you do that, you put yourself before a criminal judge who is used to thinking in terms of proof beyond a reasonable doubt, who knows criminal activity when they see it. Put yourself in that court, because in that court, the claimant benefits from a presumption of lawful possession, which the Crown has to displace. You have a presumption of lawful possession. The Crown has to displace it, and they have to, and it's in an interest of justice onus that they have to meet, and if you can make out a prima facie case that stuff is yours, the Crown has the onus again. Okay, so if you can do that, and you're successful, then you get the property back. And I say, if the CRA then gets activated, if the civil crown then steps in and says, aha, now we're going to take a crack. No, because now you invoke the doctrine of collateral attack. You say they're not exercising the mandated routes of appeal set out by the criminal code, because there is an appellate route set out just in the superior court, and then there's a right of appeal to the court of appeal, where you're still going to be bound by those criminal law onuses, and they won't follow that. The civil council is not going to step in and do that. And if they don't do that, they can't go ahead, because they haven't exhausted their appeal resources. And if they do it and go ahead, then they're still stopped by the doctrine of collateral attack and issue estoppel. So, ladies and gentlemen, that's the ray of hope. That's your sneaky, creative way that I've thought of, that I think is possibly a way to go. And if you can't knock it out constitutionally, then have your friend kneel down behind them and trip them. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I just want to actually say something before we start. I think it's very interesting when you look at the history of Ontario statute, that when it was brought in by Conservative Joe Flaherty, interesting, it was originally called Remedies for Organized Crime and Other Unlawful Activities Act. And I've always wondered if that was updated to the Civil Remedies Act because of the Chatterjee decision making its way through the courts here in Ontario. Just a suspicion, but I think it's interesting. And then two other pieces of legislation in Canada have criminal built into their titles, yet the Supreme Court has decided it's not criminal legislation. So Manitoba, their act is called the Criminal Property Forfeiture Act, and Saskatchewan's is called the Seizure of Criminal Property Act. It seems to me that everyone except for the Supreme Court knows this is criminal legislation.
The only people that matter. And before you ask your question, the answer is, you can't patent the proceeds of crime.
Can you trademark them?
I don't know.
So my question is this, aside from the philosophical issue, which is obviously outrageous, and thank you for the presentation, just a quick question about the practical side of it. Is this something that you can get an insurance policy against?
That's a great idea. No, that's a great idea, but I think, I think most insurance riders would probably have something in there that says, if your property is deemed to be criminally related, your policy is void.
But if it isn't, as you say, if
then
you're,
you don't lose it anyway.
Well, the civil is what you were saying, right?
Well,
so if
say,
you're
no.
saying you're not guilty, they right. can still take it away. So wouldn't that
work? Insurance
company,
if I was a greedy insurance company, I would say, if you're found by a court to have offense-related property, which is what the CRA is, or an instrument of crime, which is what the CRA is, on a balance of probability, which is their standard, yeah. then your insurance is void and you can go to hell.
Oops.
Yeah,
thank you.
That's what they would do.
Yeah.
we should try this.
Hi, thanks for a great presentation. So I'm going to play the devil's advocate a bit here. If you don't mind.
That's generally speaking.
Don't cut down
job.
Any laws, though.
All right.
So, so the purpose of civil forfeiture legislation is basically aimed at a deterrence rationale, right? The idea is that for certain kinds of crimes that are profitable, crimes that are difficult to
sure.
investigate because they're voluntary transactions or consensual transactions, the fear is that the criminal penalty won't provide enough deterrence. It won't be significant enough to counteract the profits and the low chance of being successfully investigated and prosecuted. And so there are two sort of ways in which the legislation tries to counter this. One is going after the profits, sort of reducing the profitability of the criminal activity such that, you know, the criminal penalties might provide a sufficient deterrent. And the other aspect is the lower burden of proof, is the greater probability that you're successfully going to have to pay a penalty. And so that's the rationale behind the legislative scheme, or the best rationale that you can come up with. What's the sort of direct response to that? Is it that
I have no problem with that?
No, but like, how do you achieve these objectives?
It. Oh, how do you achieve
it? Yeah, so do you hire more police, more prosecutors to try and improve the deterrence that way?
The fact that it should be difficult to do, right? Yeah, I don't know if you have kids, but let's say you have a house and your teenager is growing weed in it. Yeah. It's an offense-related property. We're going to take your whole house. We're going to take your house. You're homeless now. You go rent somewhere. I'm not joking.
Yeah.
right? Yeah. You're going to lose your home, or at least a big chunk of it, because your kid's a jerk, right? grow your weed somewhere else. And that's a bit of an extreme example, because there are proportionality arguments. But it should be hard to do, right? Because it's not just the gangbanger with the $100,000 and the loaded Smith & Wesson, right? It's the family that's got a home. That's who I'm worried about, right? We don't do these things. I don't go to court in a criminal matter in the hope of getting the criminal off. I go to court and get the criminal off in the hope of maintaining respect for the administration of justice and keeping a robust interpretation of proof beyond a reasonable doubt. And I say, if you want to deprive someone of their home, if they've been a criminal, no problem. If they've used that place as a storehouse, as a stash house for a criminal organization, take their home. Teach them a lesson, deter the crime, maybe they'll learn a lesson. If you Google Craig Bottomley and civil forfeiture, you'll get a Toronto Star article where I misquoted saying, I think it's a great idea to take that drinking and driving guy's car. What I also said was, after a trial where he's convicted, right? So I think the issue is you got to protect people and property because it's more than just, you know, a bag full of money. It can be people's homes. Have it be beyond a reasonable doubt. Make the Crown do the work. Yeah. You start from a false premise because you're saying, what are the low chances that this could happen with these, you know, difficult system? Crowns are really good at their job. Cops are smart, especially in Toronto. They're very sophisticated. If I told you some of the investigative techniques that are going on right now, it's the same with the joint, your mind would explode. They're so good at what they do. They don't need this legislation. The legislation exists under the criminal code, under the CDSA. Use it. Don't put in this cash grab with very little protection and go after good people.
Thanks very much. Yeah, as I said, I'm actually kind of sympathetic to that position, but I was just trying to sort of introduce some debate. And I'll just put one more idea out on the table before I stop. Another way of increasing the deterrence without lowering the burden of proof would be to increase the criminal penalties. And I assume you're not in favor of that.
That's a false premise again. Yeah. You're suggesting that deterrence is achieved by increasing penalties. Show me a study that says that. Put the death penalty in New York and the crime rate rose.
Thanks for that portrayal. I quite agree with it. My question is this. I'm trying to reconcile the landlord grow-up scenario that you mentioned with the Furcan situation. In the Furcan situation, you mentioned that because the owners of the property had nothing to do with this, they were trespassers without authority and so on, that claim was abandoned, but the same situation
wasn't abandoned.
It was defeated. Okay, so why wouldn't
the one's still going on?
Okay, but in that kind of situation where they go after a landlord, strikes me how about this angle? So, if an instrument is property, first year law students are told over and over again. That property is not a thing.
It's a bundle of rights.
It's a right.
Yes.
Okay. Now the right.
I said a flashback.
The right. Yeah. Sorry about that. The right that has been the instrument in the case of the grow up is the lease, not the title. Now, if the Crown wants to confiscate the lease, well then, so be it.
I love that idea.
But the title has nothing to do with it.
Write that down, Derek.
Yeah, that's very good. Yeah.
Yeah?
I think that's a great point.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. That's not a question.
Okay.
That's just a good idea. Right. You're hired.
So I just finished a settlement with the CRA office.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes. It was a substantial amount, and they knew they were going to lose. But my client was under a lot of pressure because this was his life savings. And we weren't in a position to go through the civil litigation process and wait, because it was going to take at least 8 or 9 months.
Question is, can I have a hug? The answer is yes.
Okay. No, here's my question, because I encountered something in the course of execution of settlement that disturbed me greatly. They claim the judge has no jurisdiction to release funds unless
they order forfeiture.
There's an admission of wrongdoing. And I explained to them why that was dead wrong and got absolutely nowhere. So the CRA's formal position, our Attorney General of Ontario, says we cannot even have a settlement under CRA unless the person receiving the funds admits to the fact that the seizure was the result of unlawful activity.
I've never heard anything like that. Let me ask you a terrible question. We can talk
who?
Later. Yeah, who's your
Jennifer. Jennifer Malabar.
I've never had the pleasure, but I...
She took over from Dan.
I've never heard anything like that. I would imagine... that seems to me to be... I think your response is, take thy beak from out my heart. That seems to be insult to injury. They want the money, they're getting the money.
Well, I found a way around it, but it was imaginative and it didn't address the problem.
Just sell the house? Give them the money? release the management?
I'll explain it to you offline.
Sure.
But I wanted to get your reaction how the Attorney General of Ontario interprets the jurisdiction of a judge under the CRA. No jurisdiction to release without an admission of criminal wrongdoing.
I just asked the judge to see us in chambers and see if they thought of a way that they could do this or if they had any difficulty releasing the funds. It's not up to the Crown to decide.
Well, it's great when you have the luxury of time to do that.
Yeah. That's
okay, I wanted to get your reaction to that.
Yeah, because I think like a criminal lawyer, if I want to see a judge, I can see one on a Saturday. But I just have to get arrested. In the civil proceeding, like Shawna and I were shocked when they said, oh, we're going to be going at the next sittings. I said, when's that? And they said, August of next year. What the hell are you talking
about?
Yeah,
that's what I encountered as well.
So, anyway, because the little body of law that says 11B doesn't attach unless your liberty is at stake. Yeah.
Just wanted to bring it to your attention because it might be relevant for future court challenges.
Mm-hmm. Ugh, gets worse.
Good luck.
Shouldn't have been your last question.